Hello, I'm Virginia Eskin, and this is First Ladies of Music, a series celebrating women who have carved out new territory for themselves and left legacies that have influenced all who have followed. From as early as the 5th century, we know that there have been women composers and performers. In the past, many of these women pursued their art with no recognition, but their music proves that through the ages, women composers and performers were creative. In First Ladies of Music, we'll show how much we owe these women, past and present, and you will hear their music. Today, we're going to examine some important women conductors. When was the last time you saw a female conductor? I'll wager the answer is never. Well, why is this? There are a lot of reasons. The immediate explanation suggests that men don't like a woman beating a stick over their heads. In the 1930s, Margaret Hillis was told that there was no place for women in orchestral conducting. You should go into choral music. A woman is acceptable there. Hillis went on to take this advice and became the most famous choral conductor of her day. She was a pioneer. This is the route she took, and she triumphed by becoming the official conductor of the Chicago Symphony Chorus in the 1950s. In today's world, even though women have equality, you'll discover as this program unfolds that being a woman conductor is still a challenge and a rarity. Sarah Caldwell is the first conductor we're going to talk about today. She was born in Missouri in 1924. She attended the New England Conservatory of Music, where she played the violin and the viola so well that she attracts attention from Serge Koussevitzky and Boris Goldovsky, both of whom are kingpins at Tanglewood, and right after joining forces with them, she becomes the head of the opera department at Boston University. In 1957, at the age of 33, with only $5,000, she created the Opera Company of Boston. Astounding world premieres start unfolding. Composers like Schoenberg, Luigi Nono, Sir Michael Tippett, Maxwell Davies, and innovative stagings were legendary. In 1975, she becomes the first woman to conduct at the Metropolitan Opera. She's on the cover of Time magazine and is called music's Wonder Woman. What leaps to mind is the amazing breadth of Sarah's musical appetites. She premieres American music. She unearths composers you've never heard of, and in the next step, she's conducting The Barber of Seville by Rossini at the New York City Opera. She stages and she conducts. She is a true impresaria, responsible for hiring, firing, everything, in fact. One of the amazing friendships in her life was with the diva Beverly Sills, who lived in Boston at that time. Let's listen to a portion of Don Pasquale by Donizetti. It's conducted by Sarah Caldwell, with the London Symphony Orchestra and with her good friend Beverly Sills singing the role of Nardina. This opera would have appealed to Sarah because it is opera buffa, meaning comic opera, as opposed to classic opera. Listen to how beautifully she accompanies Sills, which is like capturing greased lightning.
Oh,
That was Beverly Sills singing an excerpt from Don Pasquale from Act One. Beverly Sills, who sang in 17 operas for Sarah, once said, "Sarah did present challenges. It was a challenge to be her friend, to be her colleague, her employee. But in the end, it was worth it. She could turn a piece you've done 100 times into something you felt you were experiencing for the first time." Jane West, a much-in-demand soprano here in the Boston area, worked with Sarah Caldwell on many of her productions. According to Jane, Sarah was the master of the brush, and we singers were the paint. One time she gathered us on stage and began to place folks here and there, never remembering anybody's name because she would refer to you by what you were wearing. "You there in the orange shirt, move to the left." And indeed, he was being picked on too much, so he went home, changed his shirt, and he didn't get called on after that. Jane says, "Working with Sarah Caldwell provided some of the richest moments during the beginning of my career." Another singer, Dana Fortunato, who sang in Hansel and Gretel, recalls her phenomenal imagination, the phantasmagoric forest. The angels settled down to sleep, and Caldwell had faces of real people on puppets to suggest the angels. Dana remembers her tremendous regard for the singers because many conductors take them for granted and tax their voices. Sarah was very sensitive not to do this. I want you to hear how crisply Sarah Caldwell controls the orchestra in this introduction to the second act of Don Pasquale. That was the introduction to the second act of Don Pasquale with the London Symphony Orchestra. Sarah Caldwell died in 2006 at the age of 82. Her life had been a glorious musical roller coaster. Her imagination soared beyond her pocketbook, and she often had to stop productions because of this. Fortunately, people believed in her genius and in her unique ability to create magic on the opera stage, and many came to her rescue. Here's Beverly Sills, Donald Graham, Alan Titus, Alfredo Krauss, Sarah Caldwell conducting with the London Symphony Orchestra. It's the finale to Don Pasquale.
Hey, bravo, bravo,
Our next conductor, Marin Alsop, became the 12th music director of the Baltimore Symphony Orchestra in 2007. She was the first woman to be appointed music director. And this decision by the board was surrounded in controversy because some of the orchestra members felt excluded from the search process. Alsop met with the orchestra after the announcement. She smoothed over their differences, and there was reconciliation. In fact, the orchestra has now announced the extension of her contract for another 5 years until 2015. Ironically, right at that time, she received a MacArthur Fellowship. Marin plays the violin. She'd studied at Yale and Juilliard and was the only woman to receive the Koussevitzky Prize for conducting at Tanglewood. Marin Alsop is in her 50s. And her first major conducting post was in Colorado. So now we're going to hear Marin Alsop conducting the Colorado Symphony Orchestra in Libby Larson's solo symphony. This is the third movement, entitled Once Around. That was the third movement of Libby Larson's symphony. The movement is called Once Around, with Marin Alsop conducting the Colorado Symphony Orchestra. Marin has conducted orchestras in England, Scotland, all the major American cities, as well as La Scala, Milan, and the Royal Concertgebouw in Amsterdam. She holds the title of Conductor Emeritus of the Bournemouth Symphony Orchestra and has a vast discography. And this is fascinating because the older women conductors have left us no record of their concerts. Alsop currently has 60 CDs that are available. Aaron Copland, like Marin Alsop, studied at Tanglewood, and he received his first opportunity from Koussevitzky, and then years later, Alsop studied at Tanglewood with Leonard Bernstein and Seiji Ozawa. Let's listen to Marin Alsop conducting the Bournemouth Symphony Orchestra in a little-known work by Aaron Copland called Dance Symphony. This movement is called Dance of a Girl Who Moves as If in a Dream. ¶¶ You have just heard Marin Alsop, conductor emeritus of the Bournemouth Symphony Orchestra, in a work by Aaron Copland called Dance Symphony. You are listening to First Ladies of Music with Virginia Eskin over the WFMT radio network. Welcome back to First Ladies of Music with Virginia Eskin over the WFMT radio network. Today we're talking about conductors, Sarah Caldwell, Marin Alsop, JoAnn Falletta, and Frieda Belinfante. We'd love to hear your comments about the program and suggestions you might have for future programs. Please email us at ladies@wfmt.com. Marin Alsop recently announced a new educational after-school initiative called Orchids, in which underprivileged children from Baltimore receive free music instruction. The Baltimore Symphony's Orchids program not only provides music education, but also new instruments and mentorship to Baltimore's neediest children. Here is Dan Trahey of the Baltimore Symphony with Marin Alsop greeting some young students.
We need to be very, very respectful because we have some wonderful guests in our school today. All of you have met Miss Marin before, but can we say hello to Miss Marin again?
Hello, Miss Marin.
Okay. And she is the conductor, right? She's the boss. She's my boss. She's the musician's boss. She's everybody's boss at the symphony, okay? And she makes beautiful, beautiful music at the symphony.
She's a musician as well as a conductor, and she's got a message.
This is my violin, and I wanted to bring it and show it to you because I've had it for all these years, and I love my violin, and I've taken really good care of it. Isn't it beautiful?
Yeah.
But you know what? Having an instrument is like having a pet. You have to take good care of it.
As it turns out, the Orchids have been learning how to care for their instruments for weeks. Their first instrument, buckets. Heavy-duty, bright orange buckets, the indestructible kind you might find on a construction site. And of course, drumsticks. In an earlier session, anticipating instrument day, Trahey instructed the players to hold the sticks quietly in their laps. Discipline and self-control are part of every lesson. The usually squirmy first graders comply, usually. But sometimes the instruments get airborne.
Oh no. What's going to happen when I put a violin in your hand, sweetie?
Then he invites the drummers to play as loudly as they wish. These kids have the honor of being Baltimore's first Orchids. It's a music program, but it's more than that.
Let's listen to Marin conducting the London Philharmonic Orchestra. This is the Hungarian Dance No. 8 by Brahms. And we know that he loved gypsy music, and he certainly put a lot of energy into his Hungarian dances. Here is the Hungarian Dance No. 8.
Thank you.
That was Marin Alsop conducting the London Philharmonic Orchestra in the Hungarian Dance No. 8 by Brahms. Here is a story within a story. Joan Tower, one of the busier contemporary composers today, couldn't resist counterbalancing Fanfare for the Common Man by Aaron Copland. So she decided to create 5 fanfares for the uncommon woman. Let's listen to the 4th fanfare, composed in 1992. It's conducted by our Marin Alsop with the Colorado Symphony Orchestra. It's worth mentioning that it is dedicated to another important woman conductor, JoAnn Falletta, who's currently the conductor of the Buffalo Philharmonic Orchestra. Here's the 4th fanfare by Joan Tower.
Thank you.
JoAnn Falletta, like Alsop, is in her 50s and is one of the busiest conductors of her generation. She began her musical career as a virtuoso guitar and mandolin player, and as a teenager was often hired by the Metropolitan Opera and the New York Philharmonic. In 1991, she became music director of the Virginia Symphony Orchestra. She also served as music director of the Long Beach Symphony and of the Women's Philharmonic Orchestra in San Francisco. Here's a rare work. It's Schubert's Symphony No. 8 in B minor, which was left unfinished until Brian Newbold, who was the president of the Schubert Institute, completed the work. It's the third movement of the Schubert Symphony, with JoAnn Falletta conducting her Buffalo Philharmonic Orchestra. Here's a quote from JoAnn. As I got into conducting, I had to come to terms with my Catholic girlhood. We'd been taught to be supportive, nurturing, gentle, and kind. Worthless values for a woman conductor. Here's a very nice portion from Schubert's Death and the Maiden String Quartet, which was adapted by Andy Stein for orchestra. It's the Scherzo Movement, JoAnn Falletta with the Buffalo Philharmonic Orchestra. Here's the Scherzo Movement.
Thank you.
Our fourth conductor is a Dutch cellist and conductor, Frieda Belinfante, who was born in Amsterdam in 1904. She was descended from a line of Portuguese Sephardic Jews from the 17th century, and many of the Belinfante relatives were teachers, writers, and journalists. In 1939, when Frieda was 35, she went to Switzerland to study conducting under the great Hermann Scherchen. There were 12 young conductors there, and Frieda won the first prize. However, World War II began, and she was unable to launch a conducting career. She went back to the Netherlands in 1940, just at the time of the Nazi invasion. Many of Frieda's family were known to have perished in the various Nazi death camps. Her brother and his wife committed suicide in 1940 rather than risk arrest. She was a member of the Dutch resistance during the war and part of the group that organized the bombing of the population registry in Amsterdam in 1943. This enraged the Nazis because this precluded their efforts to identify the Jews in the community. Frieda was a lesbian, and she made no bones about it. In a way, this helped in some situations, but was a hazard in others. At one point, she was arrested, but she escaped, disguised as a man, and eventually managed to get to Switzerland, where she was interned in a camp with about 160 women. The Swiss were reluctant to take male escapees. Let's listen to a recording of Frieda Belinfante talking about her difficult and extraordinary life.
I was born in Amsterdam. The house that I remember, that was on the Stadhouderskade. My oldest sister was named Dolly, and the second sister was Renee, and the third girl was I. The fourth child was a boy. My mother had hoped for a boy when I was coming, but it didn't work out. I have a lot of qualities that could have been a boy, but I was a girl. In the early days, all of us had to study music. And of course, Dolly played violin, Renee played piano, so my father thought I should play the cello.
After the war, Frieda Belinfante came to the United States and became the conductor of the Orange County Philharmonic Orchestra in California. She was fired from the orchestra because of her sexual orientation, but she broke through the Los Angeles music clique. With strong support from wealthy women, she created her own orchestra. However, yet again, her lifestyle caused difficulties and support was withdrawn. Frieda taught the cello to support herself and retired to Santa Fe at the age of 85, where, suffering from cancer, she died in 1995. At the end of her life, Frieda became a very disappointed and discouraged woman, having seen so much violence and felt so much rejection. Here is Bobby Chambers, who was a close friend of Frieda's and the source of all this rare material, for which we thank her. Here she is talking about Frieda.
In the last few days before she died, she said, I have had a wonderful dream. Oh, Frieda, what is that? She said, well, I am in California, and I'm in a big, big swimming pool. And of course, Frieda had a very great fear of the water and of drowning. And she said, but I'm in this pool, and the water is up to about to my chest, and everybody, and I'm not afraid of the water at all. And all of these people are coming in the pool, and they're all from all times of my life. They are from my early years as a musician in Holland, and then they are from just my students from a few years ago. She said, many, many people, and they were all coming up to me, and they were saying, good job.
In this program, it has been impossible to include many of the other women conductors. And there are many, we are happy to say. However, it is still a long shot for women to achieve this role. First Ladies of Music with Virginia Eskin is produced by Valerie Henderson for the WFMT Radio Network. Steve Robinson is the executive producer. The engineer is Tim Malone. We thank Northeastern University for their generous support and WYPR in Baltimore for allowing us to use the recording of Marin Alsop. We also thank Alice Abraham, librarian at WGBH Radio in Boston. I'm Virginia Eskin, inviting you to join me again next time for First Ladies of Music, when we will bring you music composed during one of the bleakest chapters in history, the Holocaust. The ill-named Nazi paradise camp Theresienstadt in Czechoslovakia provided a sad and strange opportunity for musicians who all perished in the end. This is the WFMT Radio Network.